my presentation of this afternoon's lecture on the potential of cultural and sports diplomacy in supporting nation building, good governance, and the prevention of intercommunal violence. First, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to thank the Institute for having invited me to share with you ideas about this very important topic, particularly not only in the world of academia, but as well as to us as a new nation, as South Sudan, as a new people who will be embarked in what we call nation building, cultivating social cohesion, and strengthening national identity. I'm not an expert on culture and sports, as you heard from my biography, but I'm the Minister of Culture, Youth, and Sports. And in government, we have programs that we prepare in order to achieve our own objectives. But before that, I would like to say that my presentation is rather a mosaic of a multidisciplinary intellectual weaving and boarding within the grand field of international relations or diplomacy, if you like. But specifically, I'll make an attempt to illuminate how the common thread that runs through sports and politics affects national, regional, and global peace and stability. I will briefly peruse on the origins and development of general diplomacy, but I will leave that for Mark and colleagues in the Institute because that is more academic and historical. But I will highlight what I see to be the most important issues that I would like you to share, rather to me to share with you in this very brief encounter. I will also examine the role of cultural exchanges in the practice of diplomacy. And this is very important, I think, to reflect on. A case is made for the developed countries, particularly Western countries like Germany here and other European countries, where diplomatic missions started establishing cultural departments as an integral part of bilateral relations. I would like to particularly cite, maybe we know the reasons why, the British Council, the Gosse Institute, the Alliance Francaise, you know, you have heard about all these cultural departments within the diplomatic missions of various countries, mainly to demonstrate clear testimony to the place of culture in diplomacy. In addition, it is now becoming even more clearer that one salient component of cultural exchanges is achieved through participation in sports. This is something that all of us love, and those of us who participate in sports will know how the excitement that we see when teams play. I just had the opportunity to watch the recent match between Bayern Munich and Borussia Dortmund. And it was good that it was away from home. I don't know what class would have happened if it was in Germany. But I'm sure that all the Germans were united behind their teams because already they were guaranteed that at least the cup will come home with one of the teams, you see. So you can see how sports can really excite people. I try to argue here that examples of sports activities do form a key plank in national, regional, and international cohesion and harmony. Even those of us who are in the stadium at Wembley, I'm from South Sudan, but I picked a passion for Bayern Munich. I'm sorry for those who are supporting Borussia Dortmund. So in the stadium already we had tension between those who are supporting that team and who are supporting that. But that's not necessarily a tension of hatred. It's a tension of excitement and joy and how you it takes away the mind to something else. Hence, stability and peace is nurtured through such games. So we'd like to look, one of the claims that we are making is that sports and cultural activities have actually introduced into life non-conventional means of diplomacy. The third part that I would like to concentrate on, maybe of major interest to you, is to cite our example, what we are trying to do with sports and culture in order to achieve nation building and social cohesion with regards to the new country, South Sudan. And then thereafter, I will conclude my my presentation. As I said, I will not go deep into the origins of diplomacy from the academic perspective, but if the Institute is interested to publish my talk, I'll definitely do some research to go deep into the history of diplomacy and how it is connected to what we are discussing today with regards to human relations worldwide. But we know that diplomacy has undergone four historical periods. We know we have the ancient period, which is mainly European. We have the Middle Ages, again, European. Then the establishment of permanent missions, where we now have joined. That's why we have our ambassadors here, the ambassador from Burundi, ambassador from South Sudan, and many others. So we joined the era of diplomacy much later by through this third level of diplomatic practice through permanent missions. But why do we have permanent missions? Simply because we like to tell others about ourselves, isn't it? And others would like to hear about us. And that is why we establish missions here. Of course, the last stage where we are all together is the technological age. I will say something briefly about that. But we will all agree that even then, still scholars and institutions like here do have problems in how really to examine diplomacy historically and what would be considered as diplomatic practice conventionally. But I would like to say something about the technological age and how it is exciting of diplomacy today. The revolution, particularly in the fields of the internet, air travel, and communications, there is much even to come today. We talk about virtual diplomacy. For example, today you can take breakfast in Juba, in South Sudan, where I come from. You could easily end up having lunch in Brussels or London, and you end up with dinner in New York or Montreal. So you can see what type of world we are dealing with today. This means chief decision makers at the leadership levels are able to interact directly and almost instantly whenever the need arises. For example, now I have no reason why not to solve problems in my office now at the moment, because I can pick a phone and communicate with them directly. This is conventional diplomacy. Before I come to share with you what I see important in culture and sports, I would like to say something about the emergence of cultural industries and cultural policy in the context of globalization. For decades now, the former colonial powers, as I said, particularly Britain, Germany, France, Spain, Portugal, and even Belgium, they structured their diplomatic missions to include a semi-autonomous cultural wing or department, as I mentioned earlier. By the way, the Goethe institution is very famous. I don't know, maybe for those who are Germans, they even visited us in Juba. They want to help us on how to deal with a cultural activities. Also, the Alliance Francaise was the first, because they are interested to make sure that some people must speak French. Many are also interested to make sure that their language is shared, their social interactions are felt. They even coordinate their cultural institutions, coordinate scholarships, and so on and so forth. I'm mentioning this because I'm going to link it later on to how this is all this all impacts to human relations. Let me underline also that even new countries like mine, like South Sudan, and a myriad of small states, have a duty to augment their visibility, because all of us would like to be visible. South Sudan would like not to be just seen in the map, but would like to be felt by some people elsewhere. Therefore, South Sudan has a neatly truncated foreign policy, mainly to brand, you know, branding. We are not talking about branding. How do we brand South Sudan? And even how do we showcase it? So we can showcase it either through cultural activities. If our ambassador was to organize cultural troops from our country, you know, we have a very interesting country with different landscapes and different even physical appearances. Some are very tall You know, some are what I call normal, and our president will be angry with me. He thinks I think he's abnormal because he's very tall, and I consider myself normal. Then there are others who are short with different total styles of dancing. So ambassador, or all the ambassadors, including the ambassador from Burundi, is to organize cultural troops so that we can showcase ourselves and brand how we can inform other parts of the world about our own activities. But in the area of sports, we have taken it quite seriously. Since independence, we have moved very quickly to join the regional organizations so that we can compete in football. And by the way, those who are interested in basketball, they must be threatened, because South Sudan has very tall people who don't have to jump when they play basketball. You know, you can see that guy behind there, Edward. He will just throw. So we are now engaged in also organizing our basketball team, football team. Already we're actually playing to Burundi, Rwanda, Tanzania, Uganda in Sekava. We have also joined FIFA, and we are struggling now to join the International Olympic Committee. This is all because we have seen the importance of sports in branding or showcasing ourselves, as well as creating internal cohesion within the society. And you know, South Sudanese also have attracted other parts of the world through their own players. I want to cite particularly two players I'm sure most of you know. We had the late Manute Bol, who played for the NBA in the United States. And currently we have a young man called Luol Deng, who plays for Chicago Bulls. And I know that Obama likes him very much for that. And to us, it is very important, because that is South Sudan. You're actually talking about South Sudan. This is the impact South Sudan diaspora has through sports. And some countries have even gone to hunt. And that's why Luol Deng, the unfortunate thing, cannot play for South Sudan because he's a British citizen. In fact, he played for UK in the London Olympics, so we lost him. Kenyans and other Africans have been hunted also down by Qataris, the Danish, and various others. So very soon we are going to have African diaspora through sports in most parts of the world. Other sportsmen, particularly in football, I know that the president of Burundi is a footballer. He used to play very well. Some of our sportsmen and women now have dual nationalities because of this interest, to the extent that President Moi one day said that, you know, who's the superpower? Those whose best athletes are poached, or those who are poaching? And it was mainly, he had bad relations with the United States by then and some parts of Europe. So he was referring to but in a way he was appreciating how talent in sports is so critical in building national image. Allow me now to say very specifically about culture, sport, and diplomacy, the way we would like to see it in South Sudan. Because as a new state, we would like to capitalize on our talents and on our potentials in order to excel in sports. So as far as the case of South Sudan is concerned, sports and cultural activities will play a pivotal role in fostering national identity and societal cohesion. This is very important. Just hardly 2 years, and with over 60 ethnic groups, but we are one of the most heterogeneous African with myriads of languages. So the challenge for the leadership and government is how to cement such diverse citizenry into one identity. And this is the struggle of many African countries, not only South Sudan. How are you going to manage 60 different nationalities and almost nearly 100 languages in a community like ours? What tools can be used to manage and achieve national identity? South Sudanese, how are we going to achieve this? To be sure, South Sudan is not the only direct country. There are a diverse country. There are many in Africa and even beyond worldwide. For that reason, we in the Ministry of Culture, Youth and Sports have framed our policy and program of work to address such challenges affecting the nascent state by focusing on the following. One, we are using the media to explain the meaning of independence by focusing on and interpreting critical national symbols such as the flag. Because sometimes when people hold their flags, they may think it's a piece of cloth, but they don't understand the meaning of a flag. So we are there explaining to our nationals, being diverse from over 60 ethnic groups, speaking different languages. We are trying to create a history which was already created through the long struggle to tell them that, you know, by flying this flag, all of us, we are one people. It doesn't matter whether the ambassador is from a different ethnic group, the deputy and the other, all of us are diverse. But now the way we behave here, we want to show people that through this flag, we are one people. Then we have one more powerful element from the national symbols, the national anthem. And if you listen to our national anthem, it was even played in BBC, and it captures our historical background very well. It tells us, it acknowledges the sacrifices of our martyrs, you know. We tell them, this is how we came. Then we have the national emblem, you see. Then we use the contours of our maps of South Sudan, the terrains, and to show that this is a very, very important country. It is wealthy, it has potentials. If we can manage it well, it's going to benefit our generations to come. It is endowed with a lot of resources. So the text of the national anthem, the flag, and the rest capture the history of the struggle by paying tribute to our martyrs, heroes, and heroines that they did not die in vain. And this is something we use in our ministry to really strengthen that. I will come to what you are interested in, but this is important for those of you who would like also to know South Sudan. The second point we are highlighting is to celebrate diversity and consider it as an asset rather than a liability, because there is always a tendency to highlight differences rather than similarities. So we are saying we are going to celebrate this diversity. And this is done by the collection of the different artifacts and traditional ornaments from the different communities, ethnic groups, and we display them countrywide. How are we doing this? We do this through the use of mobile cinemas. You know, we are creating mobile cinemas, almost mobile museums, to go around, because we have not created real proper infrastructure for it. And we create what we call cultural caravans. You know, we go to one state, from one state to another, to show that this is a cultural artifact from the other country, and this is from that country, and they are all very, very important symbols for our national identity. Here we believe that culture will play a major role in forging national identity and societal cohesion. The third point is we focus on sports as a key area of influence. Since the youth in South Sudan are projected to be over 70%, can you believe a population of almost 10 million? And we are told that the youth are over 70%. And the constitution defines the youth up to the age of 35. You see, you can say the people who are 70% are up to the age of 35 of the population. So the government must therefore invest in sports and skills development for the youth. Therefore, our ministry intends to introduce a bill, and this is what has interested a lot of people. We would like to introduce a bill. You know, we are an oil-producing country. We would like to produce a bill that will guarantee $1 to $2 per barrel. We are prospecting to produce 350 to 500,000 barrels a day. So if you can make a mathematical calculation, if you have $1, if you can secure $1 for youth and sports activities, you can see how much we are going to improve the lives of the youth, and how we are going to engage them, and how we are going to also improve sports. When this is done, South Sudan will be one of the first countries in Africa, if not in the world, to have introduced such important project for the youth and sports development. Why it is important for the government to do that? Simply because, and this is where I think your focus is, simply because the sources of conflict in most of Africa, and in our case, in the rural areas particularly, are the youth. If you have a youth of over 70% and they are idle, they are not skilled, and they are there in the rural areas, and you have heard about the conflicts in Jongole, in eastern Equatoria, in other states of Lakes, Unity, and Warap, it is all because of the youth. Why? Because the youth are the ones who raid cattle. They raid cattle to marry, you know. So there are young men who cannot sleep until they get married, but they have to raid somebody's cattle if they don't have enough, you see. And who are able fighters, they are very energetic, you know, they are very strong. They would like to do anything for their own success. So therefore, our government is taking seriously this if we are going to curb this particular mayhem from among our youth and in our society. Our plan in the ministry, therefore, is to transform the energies of such youth for sports competitions so that instead of raiding cattle, they will have to chase after medals, you know, in the Olympics, in the regional tournaments, in continental tournaments. So, but you need to build the infrastructure in order for this youth to be transformed completely. And these are the things that we are doing at the moment in order to develop a sport as well as skill the youth. And we'll be focusing particularly in institutions of primary schools, secondary schools, also communities, because the bulk of our young people really are not enrolled in schools. We are struggling now to do that. And since the conflict is so much intense, particularly among the pastoralists, like where some of us come from, people who own cattle, there is therefore need to focus very much on the youth and to divert their attention from traditional practices to modern ways of life. In order to conclude, what we are trying to do is to pull together the different strands from the various plans of the ministries to focus on the youth through the Ministry of Basic Education, Ministry of Culture, Youth and Sports, Ministry of Gender and Social Development. We put everything together so that we focus on them in order to divert the interests of the youth from such conflictual practices to developmental focus. Of course, those of you who know international politics and international relations, the fundamental aim of every country's foreign policy or national interest is to ensure that there is harmony in its own country, is to safeguard the integrity of its territory. And you cannot safeguard the integrity of your territory if there is no harmony among your citizens. So how do nations like South Sudan cope with such challenges? Is where the plans that we have been planning in order to overcome these particular challenges. How do we surmount the uphills of building nations and maintaining social cohesion while celebrating diversity at the same time? In my view, sports, music, arts, cultural dance, folklore, among others, you can mention them, can go a long way in cementing citizens' national identity. If we engage people in this, in national theater activities, in cinema, in traditional activities. So by way of conclusion, sports have the potential as mediator between cultures and to prevent intercommunal violence. I was looking at the case in Jongole, where in Akobo, the Nweri young men and women, as well as in Pibor, the Murle area, where there is conflict. If you could, if we were just to spend time to engage these youth in games of football, all kinds of sports, you will definitely achieve to stop them from doing what they are doing every day, where we keep losing lives from our people. So above all, sports can foster societal cohesion. It can strengthen national identity and intercultural harmony. As some scholars have put it, sports matters. Sports actually matters. Indeed, sports matters because it has unparalleled impact on everyday lives. It has the potential to open conversational space between individuals, communities, and nations. As I said before, even those who are sitting in Wembley, I can see people chanting the other side and some chanting. So that's already a space of conversation between what we may call rivaling teams. By the way, in sports, you have to be ready to lose and you have to be ready to celebrate your victory. But the joy of victory and the anguish of losing are totally celebrated. You know, you don't punish yourself. You don't commit suicide because you have lost a game of one day. So sports has the potential to open up space between individuals, communities, and nations. It's on this similar conviction that we think in South Sudan that sports will that South Sudan will produce evidence of the successful impact of cultural and sports diplomacy. Therefore, cultural and sports diplomacy are a new parameter upon which focus should be given in order to guarantee internal unity and social cohesion within, amongst communities, and within and amongst nations. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Your Excellency. Now, again, very, very important lecture and a very, very important region where I think really sports and cultural diplomacy takes a very good effect. I must say I've had many conversations with Africans throughout the years. I remember the most heated discussions were actually with the former ambassador of South Africa, who's no longer here. Very nice person. I remember, you know, very, very warm, great relationship. But he told me quite honestly when I first met him, he says, Mark, Africa doesn't need cultural diplomacy. You know, it's about investment, it's about economics, it's about jobs. And he was very negative to the area or skeptical to the idea of cultural diplomacy. About 2 years later, towards the end of his term here, he came back and he says, Mark, South Africa does need cultural diplomacy. And he was discussing also the situation in South Africa where due to actually unemployment, et cetera, it did matter. And there were actually all kinds of conflicts between groups and cultures, et cetera. So there the connections were there. So in particular, it's important for you also coming from the African continent, I think, to give the address that you did. I think there is a potential. I think there really is a lot that can be done, whether it's before a conflict, during a conflict, or after a conflict. And again, we're very, very grateful that you took the time to come to the Institute today and to share with us your perspectives and your insights on the very important topic of sports and the impact that it can have transcending borders and also bringing people together. So I would ask everyone to please join me in expressing our sincere gratitude to His Excellency, Minister Ofuho. Thank you very much.